Hello, hello, everybody. It is 4:55 p.m. Central Time on the 28th of January, 2018, and it's Sunday going into Monday internationally. Tonight we've got a forecast coming out at 10 p.m., and until then, of course, just jumping on. We did an update today at around noon, and or right before noon, and went for about an hour, so maybe Copper Tropical's got that. It's probably gone off the DVR on YouTube, so if you rewind, it probably won't catch it anymore. But yeah, we got a big earthquake down here right on our letter X on our arrow on the transfer zone. So you see the arrow there, you see the letter X. And this, I think, came from our 7.1 that struck here right in the middle of South America this past week. Pressure went up and around South America. Look at up to the north. See all of our fives? So we can trace our fives back. Here, take a look at this. There we go. We can trace our fives back, and it goes from here up around this 4.9 is a relay of five, up around and down. If you add these all together, it equals 6.2 to 6.3 total. So we got a 5.7. Oh, actually, we got a 5.0, 5.7, 5.0, 5.1, 5.0, 5.6, and a 5.0. So you add those all together, it gets right to about a 6.2 to 6.3, somewhere in that range. And so that's about a 6.2, 6.3's worth of energy on the northern side going around. Again, this is flowing like a fluid around a solid object. So imagine water flowing down a river and going around a huge rock, for instance. Okay, so it's going around and then going back over. Now down to the south, it did the same thing. We had fives from the big earthquake right here, right off the coast of Peru, going down across. And then we get down here, another 4.9, which is really a five. And Nevados del Chilean volcano sending off water vapor and steam and phreatic steam, a little phreatic blast of steam. And now, of course, pressure is transferred down around. Struck yesterday down here with that 4.8 to 5.0 earthquake. And then the big earthquake struck right in between our two previous fives. So really, this is a five and this is a five. And right in the middle, right next to our X on the transfer zone, is the six. So we got sixes, a six's worth of energy going around to the north, spreading out, and another six's worth of energy, one single earthquake. Well, I mean, really, with a 4.8 and 5.0, that's not much more. So right in the middle, you see that again, it's sandwiched in between our two previous earthquakes from this past week. This one was on the 22nd, this one was on the 24th, and this one's on the 28th. So there you go. And that's what led to that earthquake. Now, I think it's pretty obvious that we're kind of on the antipode already from the 7.9. Here's the 7.9, and we go all the way back down and around, and we get to the antipode down here. It's just ironic, is it? Is it just ironic that the antipode for the big 6.6 earthquake down here brings us right up here into the Aleutian Island chain right in here? So kind of in the Bering Strait kind of area and over to the Sea of Okhotsk. And right next to it is where our big seven, it could be, it could just be a coincidence. It could be. That's just, again, we get a almost 7.0 earthquake down here, 6.6 on one side and a 7.9 on the other within the same 7-day time period. And take a look at it from this far out. I mean, even a kid could be able to see this connection here going across the mid-Atlantic and coming down. Look at our arrows, guys. I mean, come on. So coming from Nevados del Chilean, 4.9, going down here to 4.9 or whatever, 4.8. This one's a 4.8 or 4.9. This one's a 4.8 to 4.9. Can we just call them fives for ease of what it is? Because this is a five over here. You know, the USGS with this 4.9 crap is starting to really get annoying. You know what I mean? Like, all right, so I almost call them 4.9 society, you know what I mean? Like, they've done it that much. Like, the 0.9 society, that's what we should call them, right? That's what really they're doing. So they're taking everything from a 6 down to a 5.9. They're taking 5s down to a 4.9. They're taking 4s down to a 3.9. They're taking 3s down to a 2.9. And they're doing that on purpose to keep their earthquakes deliberately low. That's just, again, underreporting. So right in the middle of it all, you get it. I think you can understand what's going on there. Now, looking at the rest of the plate, I think you'll be able to understand also we have new deep earthquakes that are raised high off the globe here, and we were expecting new deep earthquakes here. Why were we expecting new deep earthquakes here? Let's go all the way around to the antipode, and we have our 5.0 earthquakes that struck here. I told you, fives go in here, and coming out on the other side on the antipode, or near it, on the nearest plate boundary, we get new, well, slightly smaller earthquakes, in this case 4.5, 4.3, 4.7, in that range. So 5 takes a slight step down as it comes back through the planet and then is resurfaced with a new deep earthquake on the other side. So here's our new deep earthquakes, which means shallower, larger earthquakes are going to be coming here in the next few days, and I'm going to incorporate that into my forecast tonight. Anything else? Well, let's talk about Europe over here. We saw activity hit in Italy last night. Now today, a new 4.5? Yeah, new 4.5 struck in the Aegean Sea. So we would expect a repeat, but a slightly different location to be hit. I'll be talking about that tonight at 10 p.m. as well. So everything we were looking for in Europe happened. Italy got hit by a 4.0 earthquake down at the boot tip, and it was about 150 miles south of Campobasso. So that's a earthquake forecast hit. Iceland was hit by this almost same-sized earthquake this morning. So last night, again, we had Italy get hit by a 4, and now a 4, 4.3, pops up here to the north, just as expected. Also, smaller movement, not as expected, because we were looking for this to go up to 3.8, but Strait of Gibraltar here at Spain and Morocco. Okay, Morocco's to the south, Spain's to the north, Strait's right in the middle. We're looking for movement to hit there as well, and it did. Okay, so let me turn on display capture here really quick. Well, does that work? No, it doesn't work. Hold on. There we go. Okay, now you should be able to see what I see and see my mouse. So let's get into the United States. What's going on here? Well, last night's movement down in the Gulf of California. And today, look what happened, guys. New swarm activity. Small swarm, but still multiple earthquakes breaking out at the pumping operations, oil and gas, here at the Oklahoma-Kansas border. Also, some earthquake reports showing up about an earthquake here in New Mexico. I'm going to go ahead and turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed just to see. Now, Oh, new 5.0 earthquake has just struck out here off the coast. There we go. There we go, guys. New 5.0 earthquake has just struck off the coast of Oregon, this time right in the middle of our warned area. And we had just issued the warning yesterday telling you guys the temporary forecast till tonight in case it struck. Now there it is. Now, why did a new 5.0, 4.8 just strike off the West Coast? Anybody? Well, we go back to yesterday when I told you it was still moving up here, that 150 miles of the stretch was still moving on a 4 and 5.0 basis, and that was going to reload things here off the coast. Now, a new 5.0 earthquake has just struck. Depth on this, 10 kilometers. They'll probably review this. May go up or down in magnitude, but let's just go check and see who's got this. The EMSC has the information. We'll go to the seismologist page. How about that, guys? Another live strike right here, right before your eyes. National Earthquake Information Center has it at 4.9. Okay, and they got fives on the list. Look at that, going up into the mid-range. 5, 5.2, 5.1. We always throw out a 5.4. We always throw out the highest and throw out the lowest. So if we got a 5.4, we'll throw that out, and we'll throw out the low-end fours, and that's going to bring us somewhere into the upper 4 to 5.0 range. So far, they've got it at 4.8. Let's go ahead and turn our regular feed back on to get the Europeans and everything else on here. And wait for it. There we go. USGS has it at 4.9 at this point, or EMSC, but they're using the USGS information. USGS always takes a few minutes for it to go populate their feeds and go through their review process. So there's our five, guys, just as expected. Check it off the list if you were keeping track of areas that we named. By the way, people who said it was impossible to forecast an earthquake, we had been months without any 5.0 activity out here at all. And now here's two fives following our seven up to the north. It's proof positive that pressure does transfer. And anybody who said it's impossible to forecast an earthquake is operating under old data and old ideas. That's just what it is. It's not. I'm not trying to be offensive. And you don't have to like me. You don't have to give me a pat on the back or, you know, tell me that I'm awesome or anything like that. You don't even have to tell me that I'll be famous or anything like that. But you're going to have to accept that pressure transfers across distances. And here's our 5.0 to prove that. And we were looking for that to happen today as a result of the pressure over the past few days up here. And I told you it would strike by today, which means that Southern California will be under pressure as expected. And our 5, by the way, this 5 that just hit, and that's really what it is, this 5 that just hit, look where it is in relation to the previous 5 and 5.8. See that? So what's going on here is that the Juan de Fuca fracture zone has gone into motion. The reason the Juan de Fuca has gone into motion is the 7.9 up here to the north. And anybody who tells you that it's not related is just not understanding the basic fundamentals of how the plate is moving and how the plate is tied together. And that's including professionals, talking heads, and even people on YouTube, which we don't even take the time to bother debating those people anymore because they're just in denial, okay? So as we look at the earthquakes that have struck over the past several days, here's our 7.9. Now it's proof positive that we're connected through, and we can go down to our 4.9s and greater. And what did I tell you about the 0.9 Society, guys? What did I tell you about the 0.9 Society? Okay, so here we are, 0.9 Society strikes again. Lambda, lambda, lambda shall prevail, though, and the 0.9 Society, Alpha, Betas, are just doing a little bit of funny business. And when we look at this, though, you'll see the connection now. Now, there's a connection, definitely, between the West Pacific and the West Coast of the United States. And the connection goes across Alaska, which is where our biggest earthquake struck. And we issued the warning for this, by the way. We issued the warning for this 7.9 earthquake. If you're new here and you don't know, on Sunday night, 7 days ago, we issued our earthquake forecast. I told everybody to watch to the east of this letter V, Mount Bogoslav, for a new 7.0 or greater earthquake. And it had been how many years since that big of an earthquake here? I mean, it's been a while. And then the 7.9 hit 2 days later. So 7.9 struck, all these other sixes struck in conjunction as the plate went into motion. Now, the professionals came out and issued articles this past week, foolishly, and now they're going to look really, really foolish now that a new 4.9 is just struck. But foolishly, they issued articles saying that none of the earthquakes and volcano eruptions across the Pacific were connected to one another. They said it was, quote unquote, too far apart. Now, I'd like to know the definition of too far apart. What's too far? Okay, can we define too far, please? Where's too far? What's too far? How big is too far? And how long is too far? And once you define those unsaid criteria, I think we're going to winnow away that that's just somebody's own opinion, not scientific. Now, scientifically speaking, we watched for this to happen. We issued the warning for it and watched for this to happen. So in the process of observation, we said that this stress would push along the edge of the plate, which it did, and rebuild at a new spot further to the north, which it did, and it would be striking in the near 5.0 range, which it did. And the reason it would be is because these were all 4s and 5s this time instead of a 7. See, the 7 before caused this 5.8 to 6.0 earthquake. Now we're taking a step back. Why? Because we're talking dozens of 5s instead of a big, large earthquake. We're talking about dozens of moderate-sized earthquakes. Still has an accumulating pressure on the West Coast, and it's still going to be pushing interior to the plate. Now that a new 5 has struck here, we have to watch areas to the south and to the east. Who is south and east of this new 5.0 earthquake? Well, east takes us due east, right into the area that just got hit a day and a half ago. 4.7 earthquake struck right here in southeast Idaho near Soda Springs. So we are due east of that location, or due west of that location is the 4.9. We have to look due east. That puts us into Yellowstone and southeast Idaho as far north as central Montana. That area on the western edge of the craton is going to come under pressure in the next few days, and that pressure is going to transfer across the edge of the craton going down to the fracking operations. Now we've got a double whammy incoming. Not only did we have a 5.8 and 5.0, but now we got another 5.0, 4.9, whatever, going to be striking. So this is cumulative. This is going to add together. We take the 5.8 plus the 5.0, that equals 5.9. Add in another 5.0, and we get to 6.0. So now we officially have it over the course of the past few days, starting on the 25th, going to the 28th. The total pressure released so far has been 6.0, the total amount of force that's involved here. So I want you to think of this force that's traveling across the plate as a separate force than the earthquakes. It's not that this 5.0 is going to be pushing itself across the plate. No. This 5.0 is caused by pressure that's on the plate that's going to be transferring across the plate. And the pressure that's on the plate right now is equal to a 6. And the pressure to strike over to the east so far has only been mid-range 4 and 3.0 at the fracking ops. In other words, there's a tremendous amount of stress built up between right here and the earthquakes off the coast that have struck over the past few days. That puts California in the mix. That means pressure is going to try to seek its way down to the south, okay? So again, if you're just now tuning in, a 5.0 earthquake has just struck off the coast of Oregon, which hadn't had any earthquake activity reported for a little while. Now I'm going to turn on a different display capture here and look at this. Okay, you see this? This is the North American Craton diagram, which I put out years ago at this point. You can go search North American Craton, or you can go search Laurentia, which is the name of the continent. Okay, Canada, United States, North America is the Laurentian continent. Well, the craton is the interior portion of a plate. Any plate can have an interior craton. And our interior craton edge here goes up across the northwest, let's say going up through Wyoming, right across Yellowstone, and then going all the way up to the north in Canada, going down to the south across Texas, and making a bend over to the east. So just remember this in your mind. And when we go back over here, look at our little arrows here, and you'll see the craton goes down through Texas. It goes down around, and you see where the green versus brown is? There are green versus tan. That's a 1,000-foot rise. So that is the edge of the craton to the south, but you'll notice our arrows now go from Colorado over east into Oklahoma. The reason we adjusted the arrows used to reach down through Texas. I'm going to change this again and put a yellow arrow that comes down and goes around, that this sometimes gets hit when the force is great enough coming from the southern portion of California and Baja. You get movement down here, then we start seeing movement over in Texas, but it's only sometimes compared to all the time when we get a push from the west-northwest. All right, so here we are. Another 4.9 has struck on the West Coast. That means over the next several days, there's going to be a near 4.0 striking down to the south, and I would say maybe even larger at this point. Let's put it at a 4.5, striking on the creeping section of the San Andreas Fault here in the next few days. San Francisco, you guys are going to be under pressure this time. It's already struck. We're already looking for Southern California to get hit. We've issued a separate warning for Southern California that's going to be ongoing for several days based upon the 5.8 that hit. So we've got two different scenarios going right now. The 5.0 and 5.8 has already pushed, and it's pushed down to Southern California, okay? And we're watching for an earthquake to strike on the creeping section, southern portion of the creeping section down here over the next few days. But there's a new 5.0 that just struck, and that's further to the north. That should be also pushing into California, and it should impact at the Bay Area going down to the northern section of the creeping section of the San Andreas Fault. So two different earthquakes, two different sets of pressure coming in, both going to be pushing on one different area, and then over to the east to the fracking ops, where things should go through the roof at this point. We're going to be seeing something much more than what we've seen already, which is just twos going to near three. I think we're going to be going a whole nother step up, okay? So really, it looks like we're probably going to be going about a magnitude higher, and maybe even more. I want you to have a one magnitude higher plan for each location I'm talking about. So in California, for instance, when we're looking for a, you know, upper four to strike, for instance, an upper four and a lower four to strike, I want you to have a plan for an upper five and lower five to strike, just in case I got it low-balled. And it could go larger, guys. I mean, look, I've been wrong before on the magnitudes and spot on in the locations. So many people will take, even my biggest haters will even testify to that. So when we see this, you've got to keep in mind that the other parts of the plate are in motion right now, and it's not just the United States. We're talking about big movement that's been happening over the past several days. It's nothing to scoff at. It's nothing to ignore. It's nothing to kind of try and, you know, say downplay and say, oh, this happens all the time. It doesn't. Look, like I said, we went many, many months without any 5.0 earthquake striking off the West Coast. We went many, many years, a couple of years, without any 8.0 activity, or the 7.9, it was 8.3, off the coast of Alaska. And it's been a long time since we've seen a cluster of fives going across the West Pacific in the course of a week. It's been many months. So it's not like it happens all the time. Take the volcanic eruptions into account, and then we really start to get into a kind of a more serious scenario where there were the 9 and then the 8 that are erupting. Now there's less going on right now with the volcanoes, thank God, but we have new deep earthquakes that just happened. What more do we need to say, guys? There's a 5.0 on the West Coast on top of the 6 that basically struck 5.8. We just had a 6.6 or 6.5 strike down here on the South Mid-Atlantic Ridge, following all our other 6s and 7 for this week. Normally, there's 3 6.0 earthquakes a week on average. Normally. So this week, how many were there? Let's count. Here's our 5.9 in gray. Let's get the 5.9s on there. There we go. So we're looking at a couple of these were downgraded, so that's why I'm including the 5.9. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And this was a 5.9, right? 7, 8. So we're looking at 8 different events. Oh, sorry about the cats, guys. We got a cat at the door that's just trying to meow to get in, trying to meow her way into the door. All right, so there you go. I mean, that is the update. That's a tremendous amount of movement in the... Oh, Colorado just hit. Edge of the craton just hit, guys. Look at that. Look at this. A new 3.0 earthquake has just struck here on the edge of the craton. Please take a look at the screen here. I'm going to turn on a display capture again so you can see my mouse. Okay, you can see that. And we're going to go look at Google Earth here. So just wait a second here, guys. One moment. Okay, sorry guys, I had to tend to the cat. Cat's freaking out. I don't know what's going on. Maybe my cat is sensing some seismic activity. The Midwest Early Earthquake Warning System, the MEEW, the Mew. Lots of mewing going on all of a sudden as pressure is now instantly transferring across the edge of the plate. So here we are at UTC 2123. Guys, this earthquake, look at this. Are they saying this one struck first? Are they saying that? Hold on. Let's go look it up. Let's see. 2123 UTC. And they've got this one at... Hold on. Boy, that took a minute for them to report, didn't it? 2246. Okay, so this one struck after this one. Let's go look it up. Wait till you guys see what's here. This must be the earthquake that was detected in New Mexico. Gotta be. Gotta be, guys. Gotta be. Hey, who reported the New Mexico earthquake? Big ups, word up to you for being an hour and a half or an hour ahead of time because you got the report here in chat 1 hour before we get it reported on the feeds. Look at that, right here at an oil pumping operation, exposed pumps. Oh, we got exposed pumps out here. Another one here. They've started building sheds around these up to the north. There's a huge operation up here, and I mean huge. Let me zoom in and show you. So it might not look like anything right now. Let me zoom in some more. Maybe if you see them, there are a bunch of little pads that are cut out of the woods on the mountaintops here. This isn't clear-cut forestry. This is oil and gas, just like what I just showed you. Pumps, wellheads, all of it connected, going all the way across the Front Range. And, I mean, this goes on for 100 miles in all directions, where they've just opened this all up, started excavating it all out. Look at it, guys. It's all these little tiny dots here on the, or not dots, they're squares. But there you go. So this one is not a 4 like they reported on the feed that got in chat. They've done a downgrade on it, and I'm willing to bet that the downgrade is probably going to be taking us. I bet it's like a 4. Just bet. I don't know. I'm not going to bet any money. Well, you know, okay, look at this. 4.2 is the highest on the list. 4.1. We've always throw out the highest. And we throw out the lowest. So 4.2 we throw out, and we throw out the low end threes. That's leaving us with an upper 3 is where it's at. Like, let's say 3.8 to 3.9 is really what it is. That's another half magnitude downgrade. I told you. They do the half magnitude downgrades at these pumping operations to try and downplay the effect of the earthquake. You know what I mean? Like, so to shave off a half magnitude every single time. No matter what it is, to shave off a half mag every time. Okay. Blanket half magnitude shave off. Yeah, that's scientific. There we go. So a new 5.0 earthquake, again, one more time, has just struck off the West Coast as we were doing our update. This is where we expected, when we expected, as much as we expected, right down almost to the point. We were looking for a 5.0 earthquake to strike. And there it is. Now, this new 5 that came from Alaska proves that pressure is building and releasing out of Alaska on now a semi-regular basis as this is compensating. So this big 7.9 earthquake that struck back on the 23rd, right? 5 days ago, back on the 23rd, when this big guy struck, it put the plate into motion. That then caused a near 6.0 earthquake down here off the coast of California, right? And then a 5.0 followed it up at the same location. People call that an aftershock. Well, now here we are. We have a separate earthquake hundreds of miles to the north on the Crete, well, on what I would call the south. Oh, God. What's it called? Not what I would call. What is it? What's the name of this place? Hold on. Not the cleft segment. Is it the Mendocino Ridge? Nope. North Gorda Ridge segment, as opposed to the Escanaba segment and Jackson segment. All right, guys, I got too much shuffled around in my head right now. This is all on the fly, as we call it. So there it is, a new 5.0 earthquake. We're going to have to watch downstream. That means San Francisco onto the north creeping section as a result of this one that just hit next several days. And I'll have this in my forecast tonight, but next several days, we have to watch, okay? And down to the south, you already got a check in the mail. It's already been sent and delivered. It's already sent. It hasn't been delivered yet. It's on its way down to central southern California. So two spots in California should be getting hit in the next few days with fours to near 5.0 activity. Midwest United States, you can expect a cumulative total of everything that just hit on the West Coast over the past 3 days to be coming your way. And get ready for it, okay? It's going to be all the way from the Craton Edge up to the north that I just told you guys about at Idaho near Yellowstone. It's going to be a re-excitement is about to happen as this seismic force presses in from the west and goes to the east. Now, we're not talking about the plate moving that fast, guys, okay? No, no. We're not talking about the entire plate getting pushed like in a minute or two or anything like that, or even in a week or a month. We're talking about this seismic force flowing across these plates. So regardless of which way the plates are moving, the seismic force flows across them in whatever direction it needs to in a path of least resistance in a certain direction every single week. And that certain direction, we have arrows marked on the globe here to let you know which way pressure flows in case you don't know. So it's pretty easy to see where we're going to expect new activity based upon where the 4.9 is now, right? So follow, we don't go right along the red arrows, we go interior on land. The arrows are right next to the plate boundaries. We don't want to cover them up. I mean, if they were on here right over them, you wouldn't see them. When I zoom in here, you would just see this red line, and we'd have to make these opaque or something. I mean, it'd be really hard. So we have them next to the spots where we actually have the transfer zones, okay? And that's all around the planet this way. So for instance, let me give you another example. If we had the arrow right over this, you wouldn't see the shadowy trench as I zoom in and out on it, right? You would just see the arrow. So it's right next to it. The shadowy trench is the actual plate boundary, okay? Same thing for up here in the Himalayas. We're right next to it. I don't want to cover the edge. I want you to be able to see the edge, so the arrow is next to it as well. All righty, guys. Would you please subscribe to my channel on YouTube? I know it's YouTube, whatever. But please, I'm trying to grow the channel, and here's another example of a 5.0 earthquake striking an area we warned where there hasn't been any 5.0 activity in months. There hasn't been any large earthquakes out here. We've been waiting for this to happen. There were fours. Now we're in five range. We've got a 5.8, a 5.0, 4.9. Okay, this is on the high end. We haven't seen anything high end like this in several months. I'd want to say maybe like 2 or 3 months. I mean, it's been a little bit. So there it is, and it all follows our big earthquake up here in Alaska, which that's not a coincidence. It's displaced the whole plate. You can see it. You don't have to take my word for it. These are the earthquakes reported by the USGS, and look at the similar magnitudes. And this is actually minus a few, because they actually downgraded a few of these 6.0 earthquakes. Like this 5.4 was a 6. It was a 6.1, actually. So first, this 6.1 struck, they downgraded it to 5.4 later, but imagine it as a 6.1. 30 minutes later, this 6.0 struck. They were back-to-back earthquakes. I made a video on it. It's on my YouTube channel. Now, the USGS came in, did over a half magnitude downgrade on the earthquake, but they were related to one another. First this one struck, then this one struck. And what caused them? The deep earthquakes from previous. Then in the middle, we have a new earthquake striking right in between Katovar and L'Anguilla volcanoes. Come on. So if you don't see the connection, you should be able to see it now. This isn't me doing anything with the overlapping rings. I can even turn off the rings. You can still see the equidistant spacing of these earthquakes across the North Pacific going down to the Southwest. There's only a few spots that need to be filled in. We go down to 5.0 and they get filled in. And then you might say, well, you know, what about here in Japan, for instance? Shouldn't there be something right here? There is. Sakurajima volcano that erupted. And then you get down here and you say, well, what about Philippines? Shouldn't there be something right in here? And you say, yes, Mount Mayon is right here. So the spots where we don't have areas filled in with this equidistant spacing, we either have volcanoes that are getting ready to erupt or spots that are going to be hit by new large earthquakes in the next few days, our silent zones. So our silent zones are in between our current sets of quakes, and they'll be filled in. And don't kid yourselves, over to the west, now that we have new deep earthquakes and we have this all going on, I think the West Pacific is also going to be showing some movement here. So you can't get movement on one side without movement on the other. East Pacific has just gotten creamed, North Pacific and Northwest Pacific has gotten creamed, and we haven't seen much in the Southwest Pacific yet, and we haven't seen much down in the south tip of South America yet. North tip of South America has been hit, Central America has been hit, Alaska has been hit. Like I said, all these sixes going down around here, that's all happened. The spots that haven't moved yet, what do you think is going to happen to those? Obviously, they're going to move. Derp. Right? I mean, it's so easy to understand. The spots that haven't moved yet are going to move, and they're going to move quickly because the other spots have already moved. I mean, we're talking about vast distances over a short period of time. This isn't over the course of months or anything, guys. This is 1 week. Not even 6 days, really. So half or three quarters of the Pacific has displaced, which means the other portions should move. We go back to last week, and those portions, let me show you. Now, one more time, we're going to do this. I'm going to show you the last 30 days of 4.5 and greater earthquakes from the USGS. This is 30 days worth. So wait for it to refresh here. Again, 4.5 and greater. And we'll turn this up a little bit more so we only see the 5s and greater, or 4.9. Again, we'll do it 4.9 and greater, you know, for the 4.9 society here. And take a look at it. Now, you might say, that's a lot. That's a month. Okay. Well, let's turn it down to a half month. There we go. And let's turn it up in magnitudes to 6.0 and greater. Notice anything? See our 7s? 7.1 in South Peru. We issued a warning for that, by the way, and it hit just as expected. 7.5 here on the Cayman Trench. Did not issue a warning for that. Well, technically, we did 4 months ago in September, but... up here, 7.9 struck in Alaska, issued a warning for that. And the areas in between, we issued the warnings for. So Gulf of California and up here. Now, these are verbal warnings. That was after the forecast. We had to get back on. Talk about the deep earthquakes. Notice the spacing on these. So the spacing on these, you know, look, I mean, we could see multiple sixes in a location. You could see a 6.2 and a 6.8 and a 6.7. Pressure didn't stick around long. It transferred across the regions. So on one side, we have multiple sevens. Again, multiple sevens. On the other side, we have multiple sixes. And of course, we have volcanic eruptions that are also taking place that I haven't even shown on this feed. So the last, now let's go look at the last 30 days. Last 30 days, and we'll look at the 6.0s and greater. Normally, there's 3 6.0s or greater per week. And sevens, normally there's, from what I understand, normally there's 2 to 3. So in this case, we've got 3 sevens, and that's not accurate, by the way. When I read that on the USGS site, I couldn't believe it, because we know sevens are not something that occur on a monthly basis. So to come to a monthly average on sevens is just asinine. they happen in clusters with one another, and they're related to one another. So you get clusters of sevens that happen, and then the average of them comes out over the course of 52 weeks. Then we see, you know, 1 or 2 weeks, something like that. Okay, so they're all tied together, the sixes and the sevens and the earthquakes that transfer out from those. So those are the big ones, and then spreading in between those big ones, we get our fill-ins that happen at the fulcrum points, the halfway fulcrum points. Again, now we're looking at 30 days worth of 5.0 and greater right here, or 4.9. So the Mid-Atlantic Ridge gets hit the least. The least amount of movement happens on the Mid-Atlantic Ridge. It's obvious. It's given away with the earthquakes. The most amount of movement happens over here, starting with our deep earthquakes and spreading out. Our biggest movement surrounds and comes out from our deep earthquakes. And the opposite side of the plate over here compensates shallow for what happens deep over here. And with all those deep earthquakes, look at them raised high off the globe here, guys. With all those deep quakes, you can imagine that put a lot of stress over here on the eastern side of the Pacific. So deep push up from on the underside here, shallow movement on the upper top side here. And in between, major eruptions. Okay, and that is your update for right now. Oh man, how about that? That's just, you know, every time it happens, when an earthquake strikes in one of our warned areas, like on the West Coast, where they said it's impossible to forecast an earthquake. And you can't tell me it's common when we've been waiting months for any 5.0 activity off the coast of Oregon. So there it is, 4.9, 5.0, coming after our movement up in Alaska, letting us know every time you see a swarm up here, watch off the West Coast, it's coming to you soon. And you need to watch in California now, like I said, San Francisco, you guys are on watch. Southern California, well, Central to Southern California, keep making that mistake. Central Southern California is on watch as well, so two spots. And then Midwest, I don't have to tell you this. If you already live there, you already know it. If you're a viewer of mine, you should know this. You start seeing threes in Colorado, and you start seeing swarms breaking out in Oklahoma. It lets you know things are about to go back up a notch. So you're about to step it up in the next few days. We'll be back on if anything else goes down. I would encourage you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared. You know, multiple sixes and fives and, you know, in populated areas now. We're not talking about some far away removed location. We're talking about right off the West Coast of the United States. It's right under your nose. Guess who's ignoring it? Everyone. The professionals. Everyone. Everyone's irresponsibly ignoring this. Why? I don't know. For the longest time, everyone told me that it's good to be prepared and, you know, that we need to pay attention to the warning signs, and they put out all these documentaries warning people all the time about probabilities and chance. Well, here it is right below their noses, and they can't even manage to talk about it? They're worried about scaring people now? When they've issued documentaries and New Yorker articles telling people everything west of the I-5 will be destroyed? This is where the rubber meets the road, guys and girls. Man, scientists, you're going to have to put on your big boy pants and start to be able to talk about these things without worrying about public backlash or freakout. You're just going to have... I mean, you don't worry about it when the stuff's on the Discovery Channel. And it's not that people take it more serious on the news. Come on. So if you're going to talk about it, you're going to have to be responsible in the way you report on it. And you're going to have to tell the people, of course, there's nothing to be worried about. But at the same time, that there's pressure transferring and large earthquakes can happen. So earthquakes are something we should be worried about, but at this point, there's nothing to be worried about. For a mega quake, we're talking about fives going up to six. And in California on land, we're talking about upper four to lower five. So that is big enough to cause damage, but the people won't panic. You tell them an upper four to lower five is coming on the creeping section of the San Andreas, and tell them that it's going to be happening to the north and to the south in the next several days, that there'll be probably two different earthquakes, one up to the north near San Francisco, one down to the south near central Southern California, north of Santa Barbara, and that'll be it. And then we'll watch for the pressure to come out of there and go over to the east. But then the people there, of course, all the professionals, will have to backtrack on what they said about how pressure doesn't transfer across areas. Right? I mean, they'd have to admit to being wrong to issue that warning. So instead of admitting they're being wrong, they're just ignoring it. And that's the most irresponsible thing. Because there's disaster managers and people in industry and billions, if not trillions, of dollars of investment that needs to be protected. And it's irresponsible of any professional to sit back and not warn because of something they said previously that they're worried about, you know, I don't know, being wrong or something. It's a sign of honor to be wrong in the world of science. And if you correct yourself and catch where you're wrong and try to fix what's wrong or figure out how you got it wrong, that's an honor. In every other profession, it's bad to be wrong. But apparently people don't understand this in science, that it's, you know, you're going to be wrong nine times out of 10, that there's going to be that one time where you come through with the correct hypothesis. I, again, went through years of this, trying to figure out everything along the way and doing it publicly. And you know how many times I was wrong? Oh, I chastised. Oh, you're wrong. I'm like, are you mad at me for being wrong? Wait, you think I'm wrong? What, I'm back on here talking about what's wrong. So here we are, and in the process of discovering what's wrong, we have winnowed out what's right. And they've been just in spin mode now, trying to deny it. Their best explanation now is that earthquakes are just common.
It's the most unscient. I'm like, could you please define common? Hey, well, common is any earthquake that you name, Dutch. Okay. Yeah. You see where I'm going with that? Yeah, common is here, common there. Common in Delaware? Huh? Maybe not so. Delaware, not too common. Oh, how about the East Coast, guys? How about Virginia? Common? Not common. Common? Not common. Oh, it's commonly sometimes common, uncommon. Only if you name it, Dutch, like we said. Hey, how about Florida in the East Coast? Was that common? Hey, how about Michigan? What? We issued a warning for Michigan and Michigan got hit? Yep. Hey, was that common or uncommon? Okay, we could talk about the West Pacific and whether or not earthquakes are common. And if they are, why do the people in Japan even have a warning system? Why aren't they just constantly on alert? Hey, weather is extremely common. You know, hurricanes happen almost every year, especially tropical storms. They're so common in the southern hemisphere and the tropics that, you know, why even forecast for them? You know there's going to be a tropical storm. Big whoop if you were able to forecast it and tell us where it's going to go. Same for wind. You got a high wind area that gets wind all the time. Oh, you're going to forecast high winds? That's no big deal. You're not really doing anything except for just guessing because, you know, forecasting high winds in an area that gets wind is, you know, no big deal. We don't even need to do that. Hey, you know what? Winter forecasting. It gets cold every year from pretty much Missouri north all the way to Minnesota. So why, or and up into Canada. Why do we even bother issuing, you know, cold air warnings and freeze watches and deep freeze watches? Everybody already knows cold air is blowing in from the northwest. It's just a given. Nobody can forecast that. That's just common. See what we're doing here? We take anything we want to dismiss and just dismiss it as common. That's so unscientific, but that's what the professionals, the people who claim to be professionals, did to my data. They added a criteria, common, next to each of my earthquakes, and then judge me based upon the criteria they added. So here we are. Earthquakes can be forecast. A 4.9 is struck off the West Coast. Have a plan. Be prepared just in case. And much love to all of you for being part of this. I'm glad you got to see it real time before your eyes. It's not even up for debate anymore, is it? Right? All right, guys. Peace out. And we'll be back in a little while. I'll probably save this as a video on my YouTube channel. Oh, finally, if you really like what I do, and I mean really, really dig on what I'm doing, there is a link down below to Patreon or to PayPal, either or, and you can support my operation by clicking on either one of the links. Patreon is a way that if people give $1 or $5 or whatever they want, I do $1 for a couple other people. It adds up with the hundreds of other people who choose to give. And it becomes something significant that I can get paid on a monthly basis. And also, PayPal, it just goes straight to me with no Patreon taking a little, you know, something out or anything like that. So there's two different ways. Both upset my haters tremendously. So if you want to fight against the online attack, you'll be paying for me to be here. And that surely upsets them more than anything else. And I know that. Because that's what they whine about the most. All right, guys, and we are here because of you. the viewer who has shared, supported, and retweeted, re-Facebooked, redone everything to get my stuff out to the world. I'm putting it out on YouTube and on the basic social media. You guys, take it to the next level. That's why I've reached the several hundred thousand subscriber mark already, and we're hoping to get it to the next level. And I really want it to get up into the millions so that people will take it seriously on YouTube. And you guys know, people don't take things on YouTube very seriously unless you have several million subscribers. So it would require all of you to subscribe and your friends, family, and loved ones to subscribe, and we would hit that mark. So it wouldn't even take but each one of you who's listening to contact a few people and tell them to subscribe, and we would reach the subscription levels we're trying to get. Now, I don't get paid on subscriptions or anything. It just makes it look bigger. To the people who are average Joes that I'm trying to reach, they're the ones who pay attention to that big number there. It doesn't do one lick of difference for me on the subscribers or on the views. I've noticed that the views are not reflected by subscribers. It's the content, whether or not it's exciting or anything big is going on. I've noticed a huge influx in viewers when a West Coast earthquake happens, but a Midwest earthquake, same size, there's not that many people that live there, and those that do aren't really too concerned with earthquakes. That's just the way it goes. So same size, you know, even if we get a 6, we've seen, you know, 5-point-something strike here and a 5-point-something strike here. The 5 that strikes here makes international news. The 5 that strikes here gets buried and nobody cares. And why? I don't know. Because the 5 that strikes in the middle of the plate is the one that actually matters. The one that's more rare. The one that should be paid attention to. And the one that causes more damage. The 5 that strikes out to sea is not causing damage, but will push on areas where there's millions of people living. And so, when a 5 strikes off the West Coast, it matters. Not because it shakes anything at the spot where it's at, but because it causes activity on land downstream within days. And that means California is going to get hit again. Okie dokie. We'll be back. Word up. Peace out.